On July 25, 2000, an Air France Concorde crashed shortly after takeoff from Paris. All 109 people on board and 4 people on the ground died. The accident thus ended the era of supersonic flight in civil aviation. But Concorde should have never seen the light of day in the first place, were it not for the so-called Concorde fallacy. This was because demand for Concorde had already fallen extremely before it was even put into service. These were the pre-orders for Concorde in 1968, and these were the pre-orders for Concorde at the end of 1973. Only 5 airlines were still interested in buying just 5 years later, and 2 of them, the French and the British state-owned companies, had hardly any choice. But they continued building this airplane, and although Concorde is considered one of the biggest financial flops in history, the story contains a lot about how to and how not to implement radical innovation. In the 1950s, the UK and France decided to jointly undertake one of the most ambitious technology development programs in history, the Concorde project. It was a technological dream that would turn into a multi-billion dollar grave. The project was so economically unsuccessful that it eventually got its own name in behavioral economics. Researchers began using the term Concorde effect or the Concorde fallacy in the 1970s. The Concorde effect is used interchangeably with the sunk cost effect. And this fallacy can happen anywhere. For example, in 1995, studies showed that young basketball players who earned more money because they were higher draft picks also received more playing time from coaches than lower draft picks who earned less, regardless of their performance on the court. Because humans hate to waste, and the more we've already spent on something, the greater our sense of waste. If we've invested something, whether it's time, money, or energy, we want to see value in return. The danger of this? That people burn a lot of money even though a positive net return becomes increasingly unlikely. Concorde's development began in the 1960s. The goal was a passenger jet that would fly Mach 2, twice the speed of sound, and by doing so launch a new era in civil aviation. Because it was a co-development between Great Britain and France, the development benefited little from competitive thinking. While competition existed between the French and British engineers, at the end of the day all knowledge had to be shared, and language barriers did not facilitate this sharing. 2 prototypes were built, one in France and one in the UK. The duplicate development and constant communication problems increased complexity and exploded costs. Instead, the real competition in commercial aviation at the time was between Europe, the USA, and the Soviet Union. This was because both Russia and America did not want to become dependent on a European supplier. US President John F. Kennedy proclaimed in a speech in 1963,
"Having reviewed their recommendations, it is my judgment that this government should immediately commence a new program in partnership with private industry to develop at the earliest practical date the prototype of a commercially successful supersonic transport superior to that being built in any other country of the world."
The US then developed the concept for the Boeing 2707, an aircraft that should fly Mach 3 and carry up to 300 passengers. Russia developed an aircraft that was unofficially called Concordsky because of its striking resemblance to Concorde. And the Russian spies did a good job. The Tupolev Tu-144 had its first flight in December 1968, 2 months before Concorde. And if anything was important in the 1960s, then it was to embarrass a nation. And the best way to do that was to do something just a few months earlier than the competing nation. This led to a strong pressure for Concorde to succeed. But during the development time, the zeitgeist and economic conditions changed fundamentally. In the 1950s and 1960s, there was great technology euphoria worldwide. Many assumed that an atomic age would dawn with unlimited cheap energy. Modern aviation, which only began in 1903 with the first powered flight by the Wright brothers, developed extremely in the first 50 years. By the 1950s, the aviation industry was already moving to jet engines and used less propeller-driven planes. The assumption that soon all people would be traveling at the speed of sound or Mach 2 or even Mach 3 therefore did not seem far-fetched. In such rapid development phases, people develop what psychologists call the pro-innovation bias. Here, the proponents of innovation have such a strong bias in favor of innovation that they fail to recognize its limitations or weaknesses and continue to promote it anyway. And these limitations and weaknesses of supersonic transportation became apparent very soon. In the mid-1970s, when Concorde was finally ready and operational, a very different wind was blowing. Test flights of Concorde showed brown clouds of exhaust, and fuel consumption was massive. At the same time, environmental protection became a term that was widely discussed in society for the first time. And there was also the sonic boom. When an airplane flies at the speed of sound, it creates a permanent noise that cannot be heard on the plane itself, but can be heard on the ground below. Tests showed that people could not stand this noise, and the expectation that it would be barely audible at high enough altitudes turned out to be wishful thinking. When planes fly supersonically over land, it's not uncommon for the sound to shatter window panes on the ground. That's how powerful a sonic boom is. As a result, the US Air Traffic Control decided in 1973 that no commercial supersonic flights would be allowed over the US mainland. That meant that the biggest sales market for supersonic transport almost disappeared overnight. But 1973 was also the year of the first oil crisis, which drove up the operational cost of the fuel-gassing Concorde. Eventually, by the end of the 1970s, all pre-orders for Concorde had been cancelled. Even the state-owned companies, Air France and British Overseas Airways, wanted to cancel their orders, but were not allowed to. The political pressure was too strong for that. But although nobody wanted the Concorde anymore in the 1970s, production was not stopped. At this point, several billion pounds had already been invested in development and production. In the end, the development costs were £2.1 billion. This corresponds to about £12 billion or $50 billion today, adjusted for inflation. So it's not surprising that the decision makers behind Concorde didn't stop production, even when the prospects for success were as dim as the skies over London in November. But then why did the Americans and the Russians manage to terminate their supersonic transport programs? In the early 70s, the Boeing 2707 had already gobbled up $1 billion in development costs, an incredible sum for the time. Still, the program was terminated. The US Senate finally refused further funding in 1971, and the Soviet Union ended passenger flights on the rushed Tupolev Tu-144 in the early 1980s, less than a year after launch. So why was the Concorde project not terminated as well, but only discontinued in the early 2000s after the fatal crash? The answer lies not as assumed in the sunk cost dilemma. After all, the Americans and the Russians also had high sunk costs. Rather, the reason is to be found in the contractual structure and the lack of trust between the major European powers, the UK and France. In 1962, the French and the British signed the Anglo-French Treaty, also known as the Concorde Treaty. In it, both nations pledged to see the project through, no matter what, and to share the development costs. But if either party backed out, it would have had to pay the incurred development costs alone or would have been sued for those costs by the other party. The situation was therefore more like a prisoner's dilemma than a sunker's dilemma. The prisoner's dilemma is a concept from game theory in which two people are faced with the choice of cooperating or betraying each other. A classic example is two suspects, A and B, are arrested separately. The police do not have enough evidence to convict them of a serious crime, but enough to put them in jail for a lesser crime. If both cooperate and remain silent, they will each be sentenced to a short prison term, for example 1 year. If one confesses and betrays his or her partner while the other remains silent, the confessor is released while the silent one receives a long prison sentence, for example 10 years. If both confess, they both receive a moderate prison sentence, for example 5 years. In this dilemma, it seems rational to confess, as it is the best option regardless of what the other person does. But if they both confess and betray each other, they will receive longer sentences overall than if they both remain silent or, in other words, trusted each other. Both nations, the UK and France, faced a similar situation. The British Prime Minister, Harold Wilson, actually wanted to end the project. After taking office in October 1964, he decided to withdraw from the Anglo-French Treaty because of rising costs. Wilson sent his aviation minister, Roy Jenkins, to Paris to inform the French government. The French then broke off all diplomatic contacts with London until the British changed their mind. The British gave in by going ahead with Concorde, although they remained unconvinced of its commercial prospects. Even a month before the first test flight at Filton in 1969, the Attorney General informed the British government that unilateral withdrawal would carry a 50% probability of incurring unacceptable costs if the French sued Britain for violating the terms of the contract. Thus, neither party could withdraw. The individual optimum conflicted with the joint optimum. The prisoner's dilemma led to the realization of one of the most sophisticated technological achievements of mankind. It led to people being able to travel two times the speed of sound in the 1970s, something we can only dream of until today. Speaking of today, there are companies that want to bring back the dream of supersonic transport. Environmental concerns are probably even greater today than they were back in the 1970s. Still, the company Boom Supersonic has been able to raise hundreds of millions of dollars. It seems that the belief in technology and the enthusiasm for innovation is as high as it was in the 1950s. The company Boom Supersonic promises carbon neutral travel with sustainable fuel. Perhaps we are on the verge of a new decade of supersonic travel, only 60 years later than originally planned. But what can we learn from the Concorde story? For radical innovations, long persistence is an important building block for success. Both the sunk cost dilemma and the prisoner's dilemma have led to irrationally large amounts of money being poured into a project that had little chance of financial viability. This can be a recipe for success, for extremely strategic innovation, when giving up is not an option. In most cases, however, it will result in money being wasted and very few people will benefit from it. If you want to learn more about the psychology of innovation, please subscribe to my channel. If you watched until here, please show me some love by hitting the like button. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.